Well, hi, I'm Stephen Holt, and I'm at the New York Film Festival, the 51st annual New York Film Festival. I've come to almost everyone, it feels like, and we're right here in the center of it all, and I'm going to be talking today about the films I've seen at the New York Film Festival. I guess the top film that I have to start with, and you'll feel like I'm sounding like a broken record about this because I've mentioned it so many times already on the show, if you've been watching and paying attention, and there'll be a test, is 12 Years a Slave, which is by far the best movie of the year as far as I'm concerned. It overwhelms everything in its path. It's, as I've said before, one of the greatest films of all time, one of the greatest films ever made, and it was not the centerpiece, nor was it the opening or closing night film here. It was just one of the films here. There's so many good films here. They can just put it there, and there it is, and it's stunning. It's overwhelming. And the direction of it by Steve McQueen, the black artist, he was a fine artist who became a film director, very unusual trajectory, who made the films Hunger and Shame, and then made this. So this is like his third movie, 12 Years a Slave, which is the story of a free man, a free African-American man in the 1850s who is caught and sort of kidnapped into slavery from his upstate New York residence. And he's a cultured man. He's a violinist. And he has a family. And his name is Solomon Northrup. This is true. It was based on a book that's only recently been gaining all the attention it deserves. And the performance by the leading actor, Chiwetel, it's either Ejiofor or Ejiofor, depending on whether the J is silent in his last name. Yes, we've all learned how to spell it. The performance of the year, one of the most incredible performances I've ever seen, in that he has to evince so many levels of pain, a lot of it wordlessly, and the levels of humiliation and degradation he goes through have to be kept riveting to the audience, which it is, because underneath it all, you sense his great will to live and to survive and to somehow get his life back, which, of course, the film being called 12 Years a Slave, you know that there's a happy ending to this particular story, which is grueling, frightening, horrific. And what is going on around him is equally so. Adepero Oduye, who I've mentioned so many times in this building, from Pariah, plays a young mother who gets kidnapped also, and her two children are taken from her. She can't stop crying for the whole film. And eventually the white slave owners, who are also probably going to be up for Oscar nominations, Michael Fassbender and Sarah Paulson, they take her out. They just can't stand her anymore because she cannot stop crying. And we don't know what happens, but, you know, guess. That's just at the beginning of the first 15 minutes of the film. So I'm not spoiling anything, but there is a moment where Chiwetel Ejiofor hung. I mean, he's hung for, like, it seems an eternity. And evidently, it took a whole day to shoot that scene where he is, his feet are barely touching the ground. And they were going to, for real, hang him. The white slavers are torturing him because he's so uppity and rebellious. And one of the most frightening things about that scene is all of the plantation workers, the other slaves behind him, or everybody's acting like it's just, you know, normal. It's business as is. And in the complete sort of mediocrity of evil that's around. And nobody bats an eyelash, the fact that this man is choking to death right in front of them. And that scene goes on and on and on. But he survives that too. And Brad Pitt is in the film in a small part at the end. Guess who he plays? And then Michael Fassbender as the evil slave owner, Epps, Mr. Epps, E-P-P-S, is the one who likes to break rebellious slaves. And he could be nominated, will be nominated very, very certainly for Best Supporting Actor. He could win in that category, as Chiwetel Ejiofor could win in Best Actor. And the Best Supporting Actress will probably go to Lupita Nyong'o. You see, I've learned how to pronounce her name. It's not that hard. And guess what? She's just not out of nobody out of somewhere or somebody out of nowhere. She went to the Yale School of Drama. So, you know, this is not exactly the character she's playing in this. She's a trained, experienced, wonderful young actress. And she could actually beat Oprah Winfrey, who would also be in that category for The Butler. No, I haven't seen The Butler still, and it's not here. But anyway, I've got to stop talking, but I can't stop talking about 12 Years a Slave. It's going to be in the conversation, dominating the conversation for the rest of the year, all the way up to the Oscars, which aren't until March. Anyway, other films that I've liked that I've seen here were The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, which is starring Ben Stiller and Christine Wiig in very atypical roles. He's playing a very shy, milquetoast person who has Walter Mitty himself, classic James Thurber short story character from the 1939 in the New Yorker magazine. This is nothing like that story, except that he's somebody who drifts off and zones out all the time into fantasies. Like he's like living in a cognitive cloud, I think it's called. And his fantasies increase, all revolving around Christine Wiig, who is playing the ingenue, part she's never played before, believe me, if you've seen her on SNL all these years, or any of the loud, broad comic stuff she's done. This is not that. And she's playing a single mother who's an accountant, who's got a kid, and they both work for Life magazine, and he keeps having all these fantasies. And as it goes on and on, he gets the crucial assignment of having to find the missing negative for the final cover of Life magazine. And he goes on it because it's going to out of print and going online. And he has to find this negative. And in the process, he becomes the person he would like to be in his fantasies, starts becoming real as he goes to, of all places, Greenland. Yes, Greenland. Have you ever seen a movie shot in Greenland? Well, the polar ice cap has melted so much you can actually see Greenland. You can see the landscape without, you know, it looks frightening, like Iceland. And then he also goes to Iceland. And the helicopter pilot who's taking him from Greenland to Iceland, who looks like he weighs about 300 pounds at this point, is somebody I know from Iceland when I was there, you remember, in 1999 or 2000. I was going to go out for drinks with him one night, but it didn't happen. And Oli, they call him. It's Ólafur Darri Ólafsson is the helicopter pilot, just steals the film. And it's a wonderful performance where he's drinking out of these big boots of beer in this Greenland bar, and he's completely drunk, and he's grabbing Walter and taking him with him on this wild ride into the North Sea, in which, of course, Ben Stiller plunges into. By the way, Ben Stiller also directed this. And then he gets to Iceland. This is all before he gets to Iceland. And then there's more. I mean, it goes on and on and on with one incredible adventure after the other. Another film that I really enjoyed here was, and thank goodness it's getting American distribution, so you can see how wonderful it is, and perhaps we'll have them all on the show when it comes around that they're going to be releasing it this winter. It's called Gloria, and it's starring the very iconic Chilean actress who's sort of a legend in her own company, whose name is Paulina Garcia, and directed by Sebastian Lelio, and wonderful story of just a middle-aged woman coming to deal with, she's having a midlife crisis, but she seems postmenopausal. She's clearly in her 50s. She has grown children that she never sees, and, you know, she feels life has passed her by, and she wants, as she says, she works very hard, she says in the film, to lead a quiet life. The things she gets the most excitement out of is, you know, singing along with her radio, her car radio on the way to work. A cat wanders into her apartment and disturbs her. It's one of those hairless cats, and she just doesn't want it there. She has a very noisy neighbor. And it's all these little minute details that end up that are built around, that end up making this incredible portrait of a woman in middle years, which you never see this character as a leading character or the heroine of a movie, and particularly somebody with such a mundane, quiet life. And it's Paulina Garcia is you know, vibrant, and she's irresistible. You can't believe you're watching one woman basically go through all this, but you are. And she likes to go out dancing, and she meets a middle-aged businessman, and, well, they start to have an affair, both of them in their 50s or 60s. And it was an extraordinary film, an extraordinary performance by Paulina Garcia. And I can tell you a little bit more about Gloria when we come right back.